Good afternoon, everybody. We are starting our session for our power series today. I will just give a brief introduction about Sain, our speaker, before we actually start the session. And I will also let you know how the session, how we've organized it, how the session is going to go. So we at Sain would like to welcome you to another session of our Powerhouse series. This series was primarily designed to shine some light on various critical areas of the biotechnological startup landscape today. We try to do this by having experts in the domain speak about the challenges and opportunities that are presented in the current scenario. This is the fourth session in the series. Previous sessions have covered Indian industrial biotechnology landscape and funding opportunities, genomics as a tool for screening and diagnosis, and startup opportunities in the agri-tech domain. If you're interested to check the previous sessions, please visit the Sain YouTube channel and follow the videos that we've uploaded there. Before we start today, I would like to briefly introduce you to Sain. The Society for Innovation and Entrepreneurship is a technology business incubator which was originally established in IIT Bombay to nurture the entrepreneurial journey within this academic environment, and also to help academics bridge the gap that often exists between academia and industry. But since then, Sain has expanded profoundly and now has provided seed-to-scale support to more than 200 startups. With important funds and access to Sain's rich ecosystem of mentors, investors, and international collaborations, Sain can help you through every step towards the realization of your technology. Sain is also the facilitator for a range of government grants to help entrepreneurs at every stage of their innovation to help ease their transition to the market. For instance, Sain is one of the partners that implements the BIRAC Biotechnology Ignition Grant, or BIG as we call it, a 50 lakh grant covering 18 months of support from idea to proof of concept. Normally there are two calls for this grant in a year, and there is one coming soon in July. And so if you're interested, we request you to kindly reach out to us for details and to see the appropriateness of your proposal for this grant. So if you have an entrepreneurial streak in you and want to see how Sain can help, we suggest that you please visit our website and get in touch with our team with any specific questions that you might have. With that, I come to today's session. Today we have Mr. Siddharth Jain, who with his rich experience in this arena will help us understand better the regulatory landscape in the domestic market for medical devices, which, as most of you know, is a very difficult space to navigate, especially for young entrepreneurs. Mr. Jain has a background in microbiology. He's done a postgraduate in microbiology, and he also has a postgraduate diploma in clinical research. He's the CEO, he's currently the CEO and Chief Medical Device Regulatory Affair Advisor of Symbiote Clinical Triology. This is a company that he founded in 2015, which is based out in Ahmedabad. So Mr. Siddharth Jain has more than 9 years of rich experience in medical device CE certification, clinical evaluation, post-market clinical follow-up, risk management, post-market surveillance, clinical trials, toxicology analysis, and usability engineering. He has supported many startups, both small and mid-medical device manufacturing companies of India, to accurately strategize their regulatory pathway that would help them the easiest possible market entry in India, Europe, and USA. Today, we are going to benefit from Siddharth's vast experience to better understand the regulatory hurdles that an innovator in the medical devices arena needs to prepare for. From the number of attendees that we have, we can see that people have a keen interest in this subject. So before I hand over the session to Siddharth, I just want to let you know that once Siddharth is done with his presentation on his side, we will open up the session for questions from the audience. If you have a question, please post it in the Q&A section, and also raise your hands when asked to ask him a question personally. Because of time constraints, if we are unable to field the questions that you need answered, please remember that we will forward these questions to Siddharth and help in their resolution. Now, Siddharth has a lot of important things to cover today. So without further ado, Siddharth, I hand over the session to you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for this holding a sessions and wonderful introductions. So definitely, the medical device regulations and compliance is one of the bottleneck we have identified from a long period of time. If I talk about the startups are facing a difficult over here how to classify their devices and what type of design verification and validations is required when they are moving ahead in their journey of the product development. So today I will be speaking on a basic aspects of what you mean by the medical devices as per the revised Indian medical device rule. And further, I will be discussing about how to classify and what all type of different design verification and validations is required for your different type of medical devices. So after having an interaction with almost more than 100 startups across India, focused on medical device and in vitro diagnostics, right? I found there are two major misconceptions having among them. That the one misconception is that their devices are not notified or not regulated. So hence there is no need of getting a medical device manufacturing license, which is currently wrong. If you see and read the Indian medical device rule, which is amended in year 2020, right, state that from 1st April 2020 up to 31st of September 2021, there's a voluntary registration of all the regulated or non-regulated medical devices, right? So I will be showing you the real website of CDSCO, how to register your product in the CDSCO, what are the different tabs and how to further go ahead with it. Further, the second major misconception is that ISO 13485, you are a startup company, right? You don't have a manufacturing facility. So you are doing a contract manufacturing to someone else. So the startups came to me and saying that, sir, we are not having a manufacturing facility. So why we need to have the ISO 13485? We don't want to have the ISO 13485. So my answer to them is that you are a startup company. You are involved in the design and development of your medical device. However, you are just doing a contract.
Hello, Siddharth. Sorry, I will just interrupt you for 1 second. Can you just lower your camera so your face is captured for our video?
Okay, fine. Now it's fine.
Slightly lower, please.
Okay. Now it's fine. Okay.
So, yes, now it's fine. Thank you.
Okay, fine. Okay, thank you. So, my answer to all of the startups is that you are developing you are a design and development company. You have developed your own design. But however, because of constraint or the funds and the different constraint, you are not having your own manufacturing facility and you are outsourcing your manufacturing facility to someone else. We call it a contract manufacturing activity. Now, if you have only a basic understanding of ISO 13485 clauses, right? They are different clauses. I'm right now not going in depth about the clauses. So there are total 8 clauses in ISO 13485, right? So however you are outsourcing your contract of your manufacturing facility, still the different clauses of your quality assurance, quality management, top management, your monitoring activities is still applicable on your company. That's why you need to have the ISO 13485 on your company name, right? And on your company name, so that state that your company is involved in the design, development, contract manufacturing of the device which you are doing, right? So that's why, again, look into it, that ISO 13485 is a basic standard which all medical device manufacturers, startup is required to have it. This will help you. And when you are going for the GEM portal registration, you need to have the ISO 13485 certificate. Also, when you are entering the market for the sales activity or marketing activity, the doctors and the various users, they will demand that you must have a basic quality certificate available for your company. So these are the two misconceptions which I have identified after interacting with more than 100 startups. Now, a brief about what has happened recently in the field of medical device regulations in India, right? So the medical device rule 2017 came, right? And further that, further course of amendments has happened. So currently the last version which is amended is on 11th February 2020, right? On that day, two gadget notification was released by the CDSCO. The first gadget notification, SO648, it talked about the medical device definitions. More clearly, it talked about what you mean by a medical devices. And second gadget notification is talked about the GSR 102, right? Which state that all the different type of medical devices, depending upon the risk-based class A, B, C, and D, they need to have a manufacturing license. Depending upon, they have given the different timelines for class A and B is the different timelines, and for the device which are falling under the class C and D is a different timeline. Here I'm talking about both the medical devices and also the in vitro diagnostic medical devices. So both these, you have to go and you have to read this two gadget notification which was released on 11th February 2020. Now, what do you mean by the medical device as per the definitions, right? Which is very, very important because this will help you to classify your medical devices, right? So what it means that any devices, including an instrument, apparatus, appliances, implant, material, or any other article, which is used alone or in combination, right? Including a software or an accessory. Now, this is very important term which is included, including a software or an accessory. It means that all the software as a medical devices, there are different type of startups who are working on the artificial intelligence, machine learning based software for the predictive analysis of different type of diseases, right? So this type of also product is coming under the definition of the medical devices, which is used specifically for human being or animal, right? And who does not achieve the primary mode of action by any pharmacological, immunological, and metabolic means. This three word is very, very important. Pharmacological, immunological, and metabolic means. Reason being why this will help you to bifurcate or differentiate between a drug and a medical device. So your mode of action should not achieve by any of these three means, right? If your mode of action is by a pharmacological, then it is not a medical device, it's a drug. If it's an immunological or metabolic means, then you cannot able to classify or say that your product which you are developing is a medical device, right? Further, which can be used for the diagnosis, prevention, monitoring, treatment, or alleviation of any disease or disorders. Diagnosis, monitoring, treatment, alleviation, or assistance of any injury or disability. Investigation, replacement, or modification of anatomy or physiological process. Supporting or sustaining life. Disinfection of medical device or control of construction. Currently, a lot of startups currently in this one and a half year from when COVID came, they are currently working on the disinfection of medical devices, or they are working on the disinfections. Disinfection of the hospital, disinfection of the clinics, OPDs, right? With the help of the UV rays. So all this type of product is also coming under the definition of medical devices. So this is a very basic definition which was published by the Indian Medical Device Rule under 2020 amendment version. So you have to look into it and say that how you can able to say that the product which you are developing is coming under the medical device definition. Definition of loan license. This is very, very important terminology because, as I said, that you don't have your own manufacturing facility and you are dependent on someone else, right? And now you want to go for having a manufacturing license. So how you can get the manufacturing license since you don't have a manufacturing facility? For those manufacturers, we call it a loan license. Then you have to apply via loan license so that from the company from where you are doing the contract manufacturing, from there you can able to get the loan license. So all the startup who don't have its own manufacturing facility and is doing from the contract manufacturing, we have to apply via the loan license route to getting the manufacturing license in the near course of time. Now, the risk-based classification, as you all know, that you have to classify your devices based on risk base. In India, as per the Indian Medical Device Rule, you have to classify them into class A, B, C, and D, right? If you are planned to enter into the European market, then you have to classify into a class 1, 2A, 2B, and 3. And if you want to go in USA market, right, in that you have to classify in class 1, 2, and 3. So we will be focusing more with respect to the India requirement, right? And how you can able to classify, what should be your strategy and what should be the steps you should follow to classify your product, right? So first you understand that class A, B, C, and D means from low to higher risk medical devices, right? So once you know this, then there will be three-step approach, which basically I use to classify any medical devices or in-vitro diagnostic medical devices. So the strategy or step number one is to define the intended use of your device. When you define your intended use of the device, define in detail the product description, its mode of action, right? And where it will going to be used, right? So once you have a well-defined mode of action, is indication for use and where it will be going to be used, right? Then you can very easily go and do the step number two, which is called duration of use, right? Depending upon the mode of action, indication for use and intended use, which you have defined in step number one, right? You have to then say that your device will be either used for a transient, short-term or long-term use. Transient means continuous use for less than 60 minutes. Short-term means for continuous use for not more than 30 days. Not more than 30 days. Long-term means for continuous use for more than 30 days. You will came to know the importance of step 1, 2, and 3 when you will go and read the implementing rule, page number 167 of Indian Medical Device Rule. Because you can only able to classify your device in A, B, C, and D when you know the step 1, 2, and 3. So now you have defined the intended use, mode of actions, right, in a very detailed manner. And now you also know that your product is either falling into a transient, short-term and long-term use, right? So these two basic steps is now completed. You have completed these two basic steps. Then the third very important step is knowing what category or device type you are developing. There are different device type, which I will be discussing. The understanding the definition of this device type is very, very crucial. So invasive device means any device which penetrates inside the body, right? Either through the body orifice or through the surface of the body is called the invasive. So it itself states the invasive device, what it means. Then the body orifice means any opening in the body, natural opening, right? Or any external surface or permanent, any artificial opening like the eyeball or the stroma, right? Then you can say it's a body orifice. Surgically invasive device means a device which penetrates inside the body to the surface of the body with the help of the any surgical operations. Then you can say that the product you are manufacturing or developing is a surgical invasive device. Implantable device means the device which totally introduced into the human body or will replace the epithelial surface or the surface of the eye. Typical example over here is the intraocular lenses for the removal of the cataracts. That is the epithelial surface or the surface of the eye. Intraocular lenses is coming under an implantable devices. Totally introduced into the human bodies, typical example are the cardiac stents, orthopedic implant, knee implant, right? Which is totally introduced into the human bodies. So these are the four basic device type. Further, active medical device. Active medical device means any device which requires an external energy source to achieve its mode of action, then you can say that it's an active medical device. also standalone softwares is considered as an active medical device, like the, all the software as a medical devices and the artificial intelligence and machine learning softwares which are developed by the startups, they all are coming under this category, active medical device category. Active therapeutical device means device which used alone or in combination to support, modify or replace or restore the biological function or structures, right, with the view of treatment, illness or injury or handicap. You can say that is an active therapeutical devices. Then active device for diagnosis. In India, most of the startups, they are falling under this category. It means that the device which used alone or the combination, right, which you use for the detection, diagnosis, monitoring or treating the physiological condition, state of health, illness or congenital deformities, then you can say that the product which you are developing is an active device for diagnosis. Then I have also written these two important definitions, central circulatory system and central nervous system. Understanding these two terminology is very, very important. Vision being that if your product come in direct contact either with the central circulatory system or central nervous system, then the risk class of your product will increase from the lower risk to a higher risk. So all the product which the startup or any company who are developing falls under the central circulatory system or central nervous system, it is classified as a class D medical devices. So that's why understanding what all is come under the central circulatory system and central nervous system is very, very crucial. So now you have, you know all these steps, step 1, 2, and 3, you have done for your product, right? Now, what you have to do is that you have to now use this, the implementing rules. This implementing rules as per the Indian Medical Device Rule, page number 167. Right, you have to go to the page number 167. And now if you read it very carefully, right, you can able to see the keywords, non-invasive, right, invasive with body orifice, transient, short-term, long-term, right, surgically invasive, implantable, medical device, diagnostic, active diagnostic, right? So unless and until you don't know the duration of use of your device, right, and you don't know the device type, you cannot use this implementing rules. The step 1, 2, 3 is the basic or the basis of using this implementing rule as per the Indian Medical Device Rule, right? So depending upon the product which you are developing, right, you have to use this implementing rule, either it's coming on, if it's a non-invasive, invasive, surgically invasive, and then based on the use of transient use, short-term use, there are different sub rules which I will be going to take the case studies, you will came to know, right? Then you can be able to classify your product into class A, B, C, and D. This implementing rules is very, very important. Now I will be going to take some case studies over here, right? Case study one starts from a diabetic screening device, right? So what is the intended use or mode of action of diabetic screening device? That it will help in the screening of the plantar pressures, right? There are different plantar pressures, and then it can able to help to identify that whether there will be any type of diabetic foot ulcers, right, will going to be happen or not, right? Now what I will be doing right now is that now just read the case study, diabetic screening pregnancy kit SAMP portable. So I will be taking the case study one by one. Now I will be showing you the Indian Medical Device Rule copy. Now you just see, this is the Indian Medical Device Rule, which is published, right? And for the amendment in year 2020, right? This is 250 pages document. Half of it is written in Hindi and half of it is written in English, right? So as I told you that the classification is on page number 167. Just go on to page number 167, right? Now you can able to see over here that first schedule, right? Parameters for classification of medical devices and in vitro diagnostic medical devices. This first schedule is further divided into part 1 and part 2. Part 1 is parameters for classification of medical devices, and part 2 is parameters for classification of in vitro diagnostic medical devices. What should be the basic principles, right, or the parameters you can able to classify. Now if you go more in depth, right, you can here there see that there are different parameters. Non-invasive medical devices which came in contact with the injured skin, ABC, right, there are sub rules to classify to class ABC and D. Now I have taken a case study of diabetic foot ulcers, right, diabetic screening device, right. If I talk about the diabetic screening device, it is a diabetic foot screening device. I have missed the word foot. It's a diabetic foot screening device, right? So in a diabetic foot screening device, they will see that whether there will be a diabetic or foot ulcers will be going to happen or not, right? So now what I will be doing, and if you we know the intended use of the device. Now the duration of use of device is just for a screening, right? So it's going to be used for transient user time for the less than 16 minutes, right? So, and it's used for the diagnosis and screening purpose, right? So now you have to go over here and see the active diagnostic medical devices, right? Implementing rule number 13. Now here you can be able to see that there are the sub rules A, B, C, and D, right? There are various sub rules over there. Fine. Now what you have to do over there is that, excuse me just a minute. Now what you have to read all these sub clauses, clause number A, clause number B, C, and D. And then you have to see that in which category your product is fitting, right? Now, if I read over here, right? Subject to clause B and C, an active diagnostic medical device shall be assigned to class B if it is to be used to supply energy which will be absorbed by the human body, to be used to capture any image of the in vivo distribution of radiopharmaceutical, for the direct diagnostic or monitoring of vital physiological process, right? If it is falling under this category of product, then it is a class B medical device. An active diagnostic medical device referred to sub clause 1 of clause A shall be assigned to class A if it is intended to use for illuminating the body. But in a case of diabetic foot ulcer screening device, right? The screening will be happening, right, with the help of transferring over some of the energy, right? So here you can able to say that the product you supply energy will be absorbed by the human body, and then you can say that the diabetic foot ulcer screening device can be classified as a class B medical devices. So this is how understanding the mode of action, duration of use of your device, and device type will help you to classify your product into class A, B, C, and D. The second case study is a pregnancy testing kit. Now the pregnancy testing kits is coming under an in vitro diagnostic category. So we have to go to the part 2. Part 2 talk about the parameters for classification for in vitro diagnostic medical devices. Now you all know that pregnancy testing kit is a self testing kits, right? Here you can say that in vitro diagnostic device for detecting transmissible agents, which is not in our case, right? If you go downwards, in vitro diagnostic medical device for blood grouping or tissue typing, this is also not where your pregnancy testing kit will fall into it. Now you have to see this in vitro diagnostic medical device for self testing, right? Now here you can be able to say that it is used for the self testing. You know that the pregnancy test is for the self testing. Now there are two rules, subclause A and subclause B. Now subclause A talk about that it will be assigned to class C if it is intended to be used for self testing, and class, and then B it will talk about it will be in assigned to be class B if intending the results that are not for a determination of medically critical status or preliminary test results which require confirmation by appropriate laboratory test. So now you have to look into it, right? How you can say that your pregnancy testing kit will be into class B and class C, right? Because it's straightforward say that it is intended to be used for self-testing, right? So then now you can able to say that the pregnancy testing kits is under class C medical devices. Taking an example of third, which is a portable ECG monitoring devices. ECG monitoring device is again coming under an active diagnostic category, but it is not a class B device. The third example is portable ECG monitoring device. The intended use of the ECG monitoring device is to monitor the ECG graph, right, of the cardiac patients, and then able to monitor continuously, right? So now you can again have to go to the active diagnostic medical device category, again read the A, B, C, and D. I am jumping directly to the subclass C, right, where talk about an active diagnostic medical device shall be assigned to class C if the monitoring of vital physiological parameters where the nature of any variation is such that it could result in immediate danger to the patient, such as variation in cardiac performance. Now you know that if the ECG monitoring fails or if he is not able to detect the parameters correctly, it will be an immediate danger to the patient, right? So in that case, right, you can say that the ECG monitoring devices, you can be able to classify them into a class C because there is an immediate danger to the patient. If your ECG monitoring device got failed or become non-functional at the time of use, or it provide wrong readings, right, it will be an immediate danger to the patient, because you are using this type of devices in the critically ill patient who are in ICUs, right? So you cannot be able to take chance in terms of the product development or in terms of various type of verification and validation which you require to do on your product, right? So now you can say that the ECG monitoring device is class C device. See, the importance of classification, why I'm taking this subject right now in the first is that whenever you start, you have any product in your mind or you start your journey of your design and development, classification is very, very important. You should know very, very beginning, right? When you are writing your proposals, you know that your product is class A, B, C, and D. Reason being, accordingly to that, you have to prepare, you have to plan your strategy of your design verification. There are different type of testing, 60601 testing, software verification, validation, bend testing. There are different type of testing which you have to analyze, frame, right? You have to conduct, and the amount of testings, the severity of testings, right? The number of endpoints of testing will be directly increased if your product is falling under class C and D category, right? The more you go on the risk part from class A to D, the more type of verification, bend testing, verifications, data you need to have on your product. So understand the classification at very early is very, very important. Further, I'm going to take an example of physiotherapy device. Physiotherapy device, there are various type of physiotherapy device available in the market. I am taking an example of TENS. TENS is a transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation. It means that an electrical stimulation should be provided to your muscles so that the pain, there will be relief in paining will be happen, right? So how you can able to classify this type of product, if you say for the intended duration of use, can be of only transient use of time. It cannot be a short term or long term. It means it doesn't be a long term, more than 30 days or permanent implantable, right? It's always the physiotherapy device which is currently available in the market is always a transient use device, less than continuous use for 60 minutes, right? Now see how you can able to classify this into a A, B, C, and D. Now you know that this is a TENS. TENS is a technology where it will administer the energy, right? Now here you can able to see, read the implementing rule number 12, active therapeutic medical device for administrating or exchanging energies, right? Now rule, the sub clause A, B, and C start from A. Active therapeutic medical device shall be assigned to class B if it is intended for the administration or exchange of energy to or with a human body. So this is what our physiotherapy device is currently doing. It is administrating a very less amount of energy to the human body for the relief of pain, right? However, you can still read the sub clause B and C. Sub clause B talk about if should be assigned to C if the administration or exchange of energy done in a potentially hazardous way, which is not in our case, right? It is just handheld physiotherapy device, and it will be not doing the administration or exchange in a hazardous way. So definitely our product is not the class C. Then sub clause C, active therapeutic medical device shall be assigned to C if it intended for control or monitoring or to be used directly influence the performance of an active therapeutic. So definitely it is also not in our case. So the physiotherapy device, which we operate with the help of TENS and EMS technology, you can say it is a class B medical devices, right? Now, one more example I will be going to take, the example of software as a medical device plus artificial intelligence. What happened that if you read this implementing rules, it doesn't talk about the word softwares, right? How you can able to say a class A, B, C, and D. But however, what the CDSCOs had done in the month of September 2020, right? They have published a list of 60 software as a medical devices, which they plan to regulate. However, the list will be become more exhaustive in near future, right? But there are, you have to go and read this software as a medical device list. Just give me 2 minutes. I will be showing you this, those list to you, so that you can able to got some more fair idea what different type of software as a medical devices the CDSCO is intend to regulate. Now you can see this. This is the notification which was classification non-notified medical devices published on 13 September 2020 by the Director General of Health Service, Central Drug Standard Control Organization, Medical Device Divisions. So now we will be going directly on the last page, right? Name of category here, you can able to see the softwares, right? Total number of device 60. Now here you can able to see more in depth that the softwares for the continuous glucose monitoring, for the infusion pump, for the control of coronary, right? For the software for the visualization of the vascular anatomies, right? These are the softwares, like softwares for the cognitive assessment aid, computerized behavior therapy device, brain injury softwares, software for the fertility diagnostics, diabetic retinopathy detection devices, lung computer tomography aided detections. Currently, a lot of startup they are working on the software as a medical device for the lung for the COVID detections, X-ray computer aided detections, right? Radiological fractures, X-ray automated radiological image processing softwares, right? Burns, right? So there are different type of softwares which they have enlisted, and they have also classified them into class A, B, and C. Here you can say that they have classified them into class A, B, and C, depending upon the risk. So this is what currently CDSCO has done for the softwares. More such regulations will be going to come in the near future. We have to keep on our eye when this type of gadget notifications or the notices is being released by the CDSCOs. So now moving ahead to our presentation. So these are a typical few case study which I have taken. Right. Now these are the more three typical examples I am taking. Is the one is the cardiac stents. Third is a ophthalmic eye drop. This third one is scatterosine wound dressings, and fourth one is the pregnancy kit, which I have already taken. So now you all know that the cardiac stent is already a medical device, either it's a duct eluting or duct coated. But how you can be able to say that the ophthalmic eye drop, this carboxyl methyl cellulose ophthalmic solution IP, right, is a medical device, right? You all are confused, right? How you can say that the ophthalmic eye drop is a medical device? But if you can say it is a medical device, why? You have to again go and read the medical device definition. I am again going back on the medical device definition and how you can able to say that the ophthalmic eye drop is a medical device. Now the function of the of this ophthalmic eye drop, which I have shown, the carboxyl methyl cellulose, right? I have shown you the image of carboxyl methyl cellulose ophthalmic solution. The intended use is to prevent the dry eyes disease. There's one particular disease of eye, we call it dry eye disease, right? And now how you can able to say that, and the duration of use is transient use, less than 60 minutes. Now how you can say it's a medical device? You have to go and read this definition of medical devices. Here is written, I have already pointed three important terms: pharmacological, immunological, and metabolic means. This carboxy methyl cellulose ophthalmic eye drop, which is used for the treatment of dry eye disease, is not achieving its primary intended action by either of these three means: pharmacological, immunological. It doesn't have any active ingredients or any active drugs into this. If you see the formulation of this drug, it doesn't have any drug formulations which will be going to be achieve its action by pharmacological, immunological, and metabolic means. That's why this type of ophthalmic eye drops, right, which are currently available in the market, right, which is used for the treatment of the dry eye disease, is a coming under a medical device category. And when we classify them into class A, B, C, and D, it is coming under the class B category, low to mid risk category. Right. Now, scatterosine wound dressings is very, very important. Reason being that you have to now understand for this product. Now you can know that not only the mode of action is important to know in the device description, the importance is also to understand the formulation to which your device is going to be manufacturing, because this will going to impact your product classification. In this category, scatterosine wound dressing is very, very important, because now you have to see that scatterosine wound dressing is a dressing which is used for stoppage of the blood, instant stoppage of the blood. Hemostat, we call it the hemostats. Now, when you do the step number one, you also have to define over here the material of construction. The scatterosine is manufactured from animal tissues, right? And it is intended for use for less than 60 minutes. So you can say it's a transient use medical device. Now I am again going back and see this implementing rule. Implementing rule number 6, medical device incorporating animal or human cells, tissues, or derivatives, right? If your product is incorporating the animal or human cells, then the risk class will increase from class A to class C. So you can able to say that the scatterosine wound dressings is a class C medical device. Now, moving ahead, I have completed the classification chapter, how to classify your medical devices, what should be the important consideration you will look into it. I will be going to take the questions in next 15 minutes. So keep ready your questions. Now, once you have classified your medical devices, right, and you have reached a stage where you want to market your product into the India, right? So what are the prerequisite requirements to do that? The first thing is to have Sugam Portal login credentials. Second is the understanding the different medical device forms. And then the third important thing is to have a ISO 13485:2016 certificate from an accredited notified bodies, right? Now, what is happening that Sugam Portal has two different things. One Sugam Portal is made for the drugs and pharmaceuticals industry, and the second Sugam Portal is made for a medical device company. Right? Now I am again going to show you very quickly the website of the CDSCO. I hope now you are able to see the screen, right? This is online system for medical devices. So now when you have to create and login ID credentials, right? You have to go over there, login and register, right? And then you have to go right over here, register, right? And then they will going to ask you different questions, right? For the manufacturing of medical devices, for the decision or notified, right? So then you have to go and write, see, for manufacturer of medical devices. Go and click the submit. Now they will want to ask you different type of questions, right? Pertaining to your company, right? Basic information pertaining to your company and undertaking letter which you have to provide. And within 24-hour timeline, your login ID will be get created, right? And then you can able to access this CDSCO MD online portal, right? Now, what I will be doing is, I will be showing you right now. Here you can say, because I have prepared this for the non-regulatory devices, right? So now you is having non-regulatory devices, and now you want to go for it. Now you have option of submit device, save a draft, non-regulatory device, and submit it, right? Now you have to go to the submit device and you have to provide all the different informations for your product, starting from the, you have to go for the manufacturing category, medical devices. Select a manufacturing site detail I have over here, right? And then all this information you have to provide over there. And then it will go, keep on continuing, right? And then finally you will get a registration number for a non-regulated medical devices, right? And you can able to complete it very easily. So this is how typically the CDSCO MD online portal look like, right? Here you can able to see, find the different user profile. If you want to add the addresses, right, the home button, right. So if we have a submitted non-regulatory devices, you can able to see over here, right. Like all these things here, you can able to find over here. Right? So this is how the CDSCO online. Don't go to a long Sugam portal. Use CDSCO MD online portal only for your medical device and in vitro diagnostic purposes. Now, again, moving ahead, I'm coming back to the slides. Just a minute. Yeah. So now you know how to prepare the login IDs with Sugam Portal. Now, understanding the different medical device forms, right? For class A and B, right? If you are already a manufacturing, yeah, you are already a manufacturer, then you have to apply for the manufacturing license under form number 3. And if you plan to go for the loan license being a startup, then you have to apply in form number MD4. For class C and D, manufacturing license under MD7 and loan license under MD8 is required, right? And if you are startups, new devices, then the first step is to get the test license, then start the clinical investigation. You have to get the NOC, no objection certificate, and then the manufacturing license under this form, form number MD16, form MD22, and then finally under form MD26. Typical fees of the CDSCO is 5,000 rupees. As a challan, you have to pay for class A and B. For class C and D, 50,000 rupees. For the test license, 500 rupees. If you want to conduct the pilot clinical or pivotal clinical studies, then you have to pay a challan of rupees 1 lakh. And if you are an in vitro diagnostic startup and you want to start the performance, clinical performance evaluation study, then to get a NOC, a permission, you have to pay a challan of rupees 25,000. So this is a typical fees involved, which you have to pay directly to the CDSCOs. Now, how to prepare an application, right? Now you know that your product is class A, B, C, and D. You have already created your login ID credentials. You already received your ISO 13485. And now you also have a good understanding about the different type of medical device forms, right? Now, how to get the manufacturing license? What are the steps? And what should be the content of your file, right? So as per the Indian Medical Device Rule 2017, further amended in 2020, right? Let's talk about this. Schedules and appendixes. Understanding of this schedule appendixes is very important. Schedule first is talk about the quality management system for medical devices and in vitro diagnostic medical devices. It means that you have to implement your system meeting the requirement of fifth schedule. And what they have done that they have an additional requirement written under the fifth schedule. Right, you have to follow the requirement of ISO 13485. However, in fifth schedule, some additional requirement are mentioned over there, which also you have to fulfill, right? When you are planning to go for the manufacturing license, because when the drug inspector will going to come for the inspection, they will going to review your quality management system document pertaining to the requirement of this fifth schedule. Right. Then the second thing is appendix one is the content of a site or plant master file. What should be the content I will be discussing in next few slides. Appendix 2 is the device master file content for the medical device startups and the manufacturers. Appendix 3 talk about the medical device file for in vitro diagnostic medical devices. Right. So understanding the content of appendix 1, 2, and 3 will help you in preparing your device master file in detail so that you can able to upload to the SUGAM portal and eventually it will be get audited at the time of on-site inspection by the drug inspectors. Content of the site master file. Site master file will start from very basic information from the company name, addresses, what activity you are doing in terms of the manufacturing, right? A detailed organization chart and the key person involved into it. Very important thing is the layout of the premises, right? Starting from the raw material entry, the assembling area, primary packaging, labeling, right? QA/QC activities, finished goods stores, your admin area, all should be get discussed in your premises layout. Then you have to describe in detail the ventilation system if it's applicable on your product. Suppose you are having a clean room, you are having a AHU, air handling unit, right? The entire ventilation system you have to be described in detail in your site master file. Further, what different type of productions, quality control laboratory equipments, machineries, measuring instruments you are going to be used in your activities should be defined in detail. Also, you have to define details the flow sheets and chart of your different production activities, right? How you will do the raw material inspections, how you will do the invert the raw material, the QA/QC activities in terms of the flow chart and SOP should be defined and displayed at appropriate place of your production area. Also, a detailed information about the handling of the raw material, packaging material, finished goods stores, sampling criteria, release criteria should be discussed. Right? And the important thing is having an internal audit system. You have to define that you have conducted an audit and management review meetings, and the records and evidence of the internal audit and the management review meeting will be reviewed during the time of manufacturing license audit. This is our typical content requirement side master file. Now moving towards the device master file. Now here you can able to see I have written various standards name. The beauty of the medical device in vitro diagnostics is that for each critical area you have a standard. You have to just read the standard, follow it, prepare the SOPs, protocol and report. This is what the expectations or the drug inspectors, notified bodies are. So the content starts from the basic device description and intended use, which you have already done very in beginning of your design and development cycle. Classify your devices, provide in detail rationals and device description and intended use. Provide in detail three batch design and development validation data. Is very important. Prepare a risk management report meeting the requirement of ISO 14971 to 2019. ISO 14971 is the requirement to be fulfilled by the medical device manufacturers for the risk management analysis. When you plan to go for clinical evaluation, right? For the clinical evaluation, you have to follow the requirement of ISO 14155 2020, which is recently amended in the month of February 2020. Right, you have to follow what should be the typical content of a clinical trial protocol, informed consent form, all is written in detail under this standard. Then you also have to prepare a label for the labeling the standard the ISO 15223. For the IFU, you have to provide different symbols. Also in the IFU label, so the symbols and everything is written in the 2041 and 15223. Then the biocompatibility requirements, you have to fulfill the requirement of ISO 10993-1 2018. You have to say that what different type of testings you will require depending upon the duration of use of your device. If you read the standard biocompatibility reports, I'll talk about the contact duration, right? Contact duration less than 24 hours, more than 24 hours, permanent, right? And then where are you going to be contact? Skin, right? Or if it's in skin or what we call it implantable, right? Either in contact with the blood or channeling. So there are different criteria which is mentioned under the ISO 10993 accordingly to which you have to see that in which category your product is falling into it. And then you have to plan the different testings like cytotoxicity, irritation, sensitization, implantation test, hemocompatibility, chronic toxicity, genotoxicities. There are different tests which you have to identify which is more applicable to you. Then electrical safety testings meeting the requirement of 60601 if your product is falling under the active device categories. If your product having a standalone software or your device is integrated into the software, then you have to fulfill the requirement of ISO, ISO 62304, which is the requirement of validation and verification of softwares. You have to provide the post-marketing service plan and report, customer feedback, customer complaint, various adverse events which you have identified or have with respect to your product. Currently in India, very recently, the Metro Vigilance report has been published. What is metallovigilance? Metallovigilance is that if there is any type of adverse event reported with respect to your product device in India, you have to fill the adverse event report, right? And then you have to file it to the CDSU and the respective departments. We call it the word metallovigilance. Then for the packaging validations, you have to fulfill the requirement of ISO 11607. There are two parts, part one and part two. If the product is using the ET validation, then there's again a particular standard of ISO 11135. And for stability studies, it's ASTM F1980, right? So there are more than 1,000 standards for a medical device currently available. Depending upon the product which you are manufacturing, it is your responsibility to identify that particular standard, understand the requirement, and at the stage of design input only. So that whenever you are preparing your first proof of concept device, so all those particular requirements are fulfilled. So this will be a typical content or typical requirement of a device master file for medical devices. Now moving towards the in vitro diagnostics. Now what happened for the in vitro diagnostic? The things will remain the same, right? The changes are in the performance evaluation. In vitro diagnostic, we don't use the word clinical validation. We use the word performance evaluation. And in performance evaluation, the sensitivity, specificity, reproducibility, repeatability, right? Different type of analytical testings, right? As I said, there are different type of testings which you have to do to validate your numbers. And then again, the post-marketing surveillance, packaging validation, stability studies, all will remain, the standard requirement will remain the same. Either you are a medical device or in vitro. That main change is in your performance evaluation, how you will do the performance evaluation of your product, and how you will establish the analytical studies, or what we call it the qualitative or quantitative studies of your product. So this will be your typical content. Once you have prepared all these files, then you have to again go to the CDSU and be online. You have to upload your document, and then the audit will get triggered, and accordingly you will be getting the manufacturing license for your product of class A, B, C, and D. The typical timeline, what I am saying right now is that for class A and B, currently it is a voluntary registration till 30 September 2021. And after 30 September, it will become mandatory till 30 September 2022 for class A and B. For class C and D manufacturers and startups, it is again a voluntary until 30 September 2021, and then it become mandatory till 30 September 2023, right? So currently plan your strategies, plan your work, meeting this requirement so that you can be able to enter the market and start selling the products, right? So now this, I'm closing the session, it's 5 o'clock. I will not take the questions from the startups. We have still 15-20 minutes to take the questions.
Thank you, Siddharth, for this extremely detailed and interesting talk.
Thank you.
I will open up the session to a couple of questions, and I will pose some of these questions that are in the chat box.
Yeah.
I wanted to start with this. This is a question from Vivek. He wants to know if to develop a proof of concept prototype, a single piece of technology demonstration of a medical device in an academic research lab within a university or institute, does one need to do this registration?
No. Just for developing the proof of concept device, there's no requirement to do this type of registration work. Once your proof of concept device is developed, you have established the its performance, verification, validation, and when you plan to enter into the Indian market, during that time, this type of activities like your ISO 13485 or your manufacturing license or registration is required.
Okay. Thank you for that. Another question is, nowadays there are lots of wearables that measure various vital parameters like ECG, SpO2, heart rate, etc. Do they classify as a medical device?
Yes. These are medical devices. These all are coming under medical device categories only right now. These all are coming under an active diagnostic category. You see that these all are measuring the vital physiological parameters. Right, SpO2, blood pressures, these all are coming under the category of active medical devices, and these all are medical devices.
So can you specify which particular category this comes under?
This comes under an active diagnostic category.
Active diagnostic category, okay. So I just had a question from my end, and if any of the participants have further questions, please either post them in the Q&A or you can even raise your hands, we allow you to ask the questions directly to Siddharth. So Siddharth, again, my question is related to the early innovators. You mentioned in your talk how important classification, risk assessment, and the general know-how of the semantics, et cetera, of the regulatory framework is so important in an innovator's roadmap. So you've helped many big grantees, as you've told us, and other early startups to set their roadmaps for to commercialization, right?
Right.
So
right.
Regarding this, can you throw some light on where in this roadmap should the regulation part be mapped in? How much funds should one apportion? And going through the steps that you did, it sometimes can get quite complex. Where can these startups get help in understanding where their innovation lies in the regulatory framework?
Right, right, right. So at the very early stage, so currently, if I talk about the BioBig grantees, currently I'm supporting many BioBig grantees, more than 30, 40 BioBig grantees currently I'm supporting, right? So the development of the regulatory strategy roadmap is very crucial. Vision being that currently you have 18 month duration of your time to develop the proof of concept under the BioBig grant, right? And depending upon the product which you are manufacturing or which you want to develop the proof of concept device, right? So for each and every product, right, you have to first identify the class, which is very, very important. This should be your step number one. If I say the step by step, your step number one should be doing the classification of your medical device into class A, B, C, and D. Once you have done it, right, then the second step is to understand what are the requirement of your design verification. Design verification means that different type of bend testing data, different type of product related standards, different type of performance studies you have to perform, right? At a time when you reach the design verification. I'm again going back a little bit, going back at the stage of what you mean by the design development lifecycle. Start from the design planning, design input, design output, design review, design verification and validation, right? So you know that you want to develop a proof of concept device, right? And you have 18 month duration of timeline. So the first step is to find the intended use, to find your product class. The third step is identify all the different design verification, performance related, product related standards at very early in your journey. Because when you go in the design input part, right, you are having some expectations from your device, right? To meet this expectations in terms of clinical performance, technical, regulatory, you should know what are the standards all about. You have to enlist at the very beginning so that when your proof of concept device is coming, right, so that you have a device which is fulfilling all the regulatory requirements, right? So this strategy buildup is very important for the startups, so that this will help us in aligning your funds. So as ma'am said, how much funds should be allocated by the big grantees or who plan to go for the big grants, right? I would say from my experience, anything between 5 lakh to 6 lakh of rupees, you have to put aside for having a good regulatory strategy and to complete maximum of your regulatory strategy work done during this 18 month of timeline.
Thank you, Siddharth. Can you stop sharing the screen from your end?
I'll take
a live question from Dr. Lini Basil. Okay. Lini, you can go ahead and ask your question.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
My product is a hydrating patch for dry mouth patients. So it is being used inside the oral cavity for 8 hours. This patch contains collagen and aloe vera. So when we consulted a regulatory person, so he said that the collagen being a animal tissue might have indications in this class A or class C. So the collagen we use as not viable cells. We are buying as a powdered collagen form. So what class does it fall into, class A or class C?
So if you see the rule, there's a difference is provided into viable and non-viable, right? So you have to, so viable and non-viable, it is provided that a medical device referred shall be assigned to class A if it is manufactured from or incorporated non-viable animal tissues, right? Right. Okay. So you are saying that it's a non-viable, right? So
yes.
So however, you have to provide the TSC and BSC certificate. These are two basic certificates which state that the origin of your collagen, right? Either it will be a bovine origin, right? You might, it will be a bovine origin, collagens are coming, right? So so the regulator will ask you, show me the certificate of TSC and BSC. These are and then you can able to say that it's a class A non-viable collagen we are using, then it's a class A devices.
So, sir, how do we obtain this TSC or BSC certificate? It is from the vendor.
Yeah, you have to ask. You have to ask the vendor, because the vendor's duty to provide this TSC BSC. If you plan to go, if you want to have your own TSC BSC, it will be very difficult, because there are very few labs in India only to do this type of TSC BSC certificates or testings.
Oh, okay, sir. So, does this aloe vera, the presence of aloe vera, has any implication in the classification?
No, it will not going to be.
Okay, thank you very much, sir.
Hi, Siddharth. The next question is from Pramod, and he wants to know what is the difference between regulatory versus non-regulatory or non-classified device. But I think he's talking about notified and non-notified devices.
So the difference.
He has two more questions. His question is, what is the classification of non-invasive ventilators and oxygen concentrators?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And could you just explain a little bit about the timeline that you spoke about in slide 23? Is it the time that it takes for the proceedings of the approvals?
Okay, fine. I understand. Okay. So now there are different terminology, different person uses, regulated, non-regulated, classified, non-classified, right? So all the things are same, and there are two things: regulated device and non-regulated devices, right? So the regulated device, it means that there are certain list of devices, 24 to 30 devices, which are regulated by the CDSU, and to get the manufacturing license is compulsory, and right, and there's the second set of devices, right, which are non-regulated. Getting the manufacturing license is currently under the voluntary registration period. You have to just apply to the CDSU MD online, and you will able to get this registration number. So this is what the difference of getting the manufacturing license for the regulated and non-regulated or non-classified device. Your second question is, what is the classification on non-invasive ventilators and oxygen concentrators? Right. So non-invasive ventilators, they are coming under class C devices. Reason being, it will be going to impact on directly the health of the patients. If your ventilators will become stop working, right, in the ICUs, so it will be coming under the class C medical devices. Oxygen concentrators is coming under the class B medical devices as of now. Slide 23 timeline, can you please explain? Okay, slide number 23. Let me see the slide number 23. Okay, for getting the in vitro diagnostics, or for preparing the device master file, right? So the timeline of preparing and uploading a document and getting the manufacturing license, you can say anything between 3 to 6 months of timeline you can be able to devote.
I hope, Pramod, that answers most of your questions. Thank you, Siddharth. There's just one other question as a follow-up. I'll ask it about that smart wearables. Mm-hmm. It's like, there are a lot of smartwatches these days, right, which do not show any medical device class or ISO certification. So do such devices like wearables that are smart wearables, do they need to show ethical clearance or clinical trial results for their performance?
Yeah, definitely. If I talk about the, I just give an example of Apple Watch, right? Apple Watch is already in US FDA certified in USA, right? But however, what is happening in India that because of this, rules and regulations are not very strict, right? There are a lot of smartwatch manufacturers are coming in India who are selling the product without having a proper license. these all products are coming under an active diagnostic categories, right? But however, currently most of the startups, like as one of the attendees has mentioned, the company name GoKick, right? They have already got the ISO 13485, and if you go on the website, they have already got the registration number from the CDSU. So those manufacturers or those traders who are aware about these regulations, they are currently going voluntary to get the ISO 13485 and all the regulations in place. It all depends upon the how they are aware about these regulations of India.
Thank you for that answer. So there's one other question from Rajat Haldar. He wants to know that they're developing a phototherapy and baby radiant warmer device, mm-hmm. but they can't find any lab to get it tested. So what advice would you give them?
No, there are labs. See, for the baby warmers, they are a particular 60601 standard, right? IC 60601, 80601 standards are particular for this baby warmers, right? So you have to approach UL. UL is doing this type of testing. TEV Studio, TEV Rheinland, they are doing this type of testing in India.
Okay, thank you. I just have another question. So when we talk about, okay, it's the same thing. Okay, let me take this from Yogmaya Verma. Why an exploratory academic trial of novel medical device requires CLA approval and test license to manufacture the test devices?
Right, yeah, so the answer is that the main authority to give you the NOC is a no objection certificate to conduct the clinical trial. Either it's an academic or it's an industrial, right? You have to approach the CDSU Central Delhi office only, right? It is not governed from the state FDA. State FDA has no role in giving you the NOC. And also for getting the test license, right? So how the steps work? The step number one is to first get the test license, right? To manufacture the small quantity of devices for initiating the clinical studies. So once you got the test license for your product, right, then the set number second is that initiate the NOC, no objection certificate application for your clinical studies, and submit it again to the CDSUs. CDSU had two different portals, had two different committees. One is for testing the granting test license, which you can able to get it in a 1 week duration of timeline. But however, for the NOC, they have different 12 to 14 committees depending upon the therapeutic areas. Suppose you are developing a device falling under the cardiology area. So your application will be forwarded to the cardiology committee, which is formed under the clinical trial committee of the CDSUs. So this is how it will going to work for getting the NOC for your either academic trial or a industrial trial.
Okay, we have another question from Jaya Shukla. She says her device is microspheres used for liver cancer therapy after radio labeling. She wants to know how she can get approval.
So it is a microsphere. And then further, can you just repeat it again?
Her device is microspheres used for liver cancer therapy after radio labeling. And she wants to know how to get approval.
So it's a microsphere. So definitely it's a encapsulation of the some of the radioactive particles, this microsphere, right? And then it is a site directed release of this microsphere at the cancer site, right? This correct intended use, what I have understand.
I will just ask the panelist if she can please raise her hand. She's raised her hand. Yeah, we'll allow her to ask you the question directly.
Yeah.
Jaya, please unmute yourself and ask the question. Can you unmute her? Hello, Jaya. Can you unmute yourself from your end and ask the question? Okay, we'll move on to one other person.
Hello.
Okay, yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. So my microspheres are delivered through transarterial catheter to the liver cancer, to the cancer cells. So they stay there, and we call these microspheres are come in under the category of medical devices.
Right.
So how to get a license or the approval for manufacturing, whether it will come under a device or under drug?
No, it will coming under a device only, because in your microsphere, right, you have radioactive particles, right, encapsulated into this microspheres, right, and with the help of the catheter you are injecting at the site. And then the microsphere will go at the site, microsphere will get dispersed, and the radioactive particle will become released. And it will
sir. No, it will not be released. Okay. And whatever I will prepare will be the non-radioactive carrier particles in some lab, right? In some factory. So it will come under medical device. Right. And then the hospital which is going to use it will radio label it. And deliver, and it will not be dispersed, no leaching. It will stay there until it will decay.
Okay, so it means that the radioactive labeling is not carried by you. You are only providing the microspheres, right?
Microsphere for carrier, microspheres.
So your company role is only to develop this microspheres and transfer this microspheres to the hospital. Hospital role is to radio label
it and deliver. Okay.
So then in that case you have to get the manufacturing license for your microspheres.
Yes, right? Sir.
Only you require to get the microsphere. See, this type of product is very novel in India, right? And you need to have a lot of verification and in detail clinical data to be submitted to the CDSCO to get the manufacturing license.
Sir, I am working in a hospital. I am additional professor in Postgraduate Institute of Medical Sciences, Chandigarh.
Okay.
PGMER.
Okay. Okay.
So there we have tested in 45 patients.
Okay.
It is, and I have got ethical clearance. I mean, I have got three ethical clearances, one for feasibility, then for mix. First, I have formulated radioactive one. Then it is difficult because these have limited half-life. I mean, otherwise they will decay. They will be of no use. So I have prepared a cold kit so that whenever doctor want to use it, they can label in their hospital. And they're very simple way to prepare it. And then also I got ethical clearance to use it in human from my institute. And I also have a ICMR funded project. Okay. For that also I have got ethical clearance from my institute. Okay. So I have now 45 patient data, patients data, and 30 patient data is already published in an international journal.
Okay, great. Yeah, so now if you have all this data available, right?
Right.
Then you have to stay forward, initiate the process of getting the ISO 13485 certificate, start the documenting work and preparing your device master file, what I have mentioned, start preparing the device master file and initiate the process of getting the manufacturing license for your product.
So that how to proceed, I mean, whom to contact and how to go there. I mean, I have no clue. I am searching from CDSO site and all. So it will come under device only, right?
Yeah, it will come under device only. Yeah,
100% device. Because of the time constraint, maybe we can take this offline to us and we can connect you with Mr. Jain. And
sure, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
So I just have a quick question for you, Siddharth, before we kind of wrap up this session. Can you speak about the first hub initiative from BIRAC a little bit?
Yeah, yeah. Right. So currently, for the startups, what the BIREC has done very recently, not recently, from a quite long period of time, right? They have launched a first hub. What is the first hub, right? If you have any queries with respect to the CDSEO, right? With respect to your classification or how to approach the CDSEO, or if you're not getting an answer from the CDSEO, or you want to apply, right? Over there, right? So then you have to approach the first hub of BIREC. They have a limited duration of time, right? You have to pre-apply to the first hub. You have to apply over there. And then depending upon a time slot given to you, you can able to directly, you mean the startup can directly able to interact with the CDSEO, the regulators, with respect to any queries they have with respect to their product, with the classification, how to upload the documents, anything with respect to the CDSEO, the first hub team of BIREC can able to support you over there. So just type on Google first hub BIREC, you can able to see the web page and upload your questions over there. BIREC people will approach to you, they will fix a meeting date, time, and accordingly you can able to interact directly with the CDSEO, the regulators, for any question with respect to your manufacturing license.
Okay, Siddharth, this has been a very, very informative session, and I'm sure the participants appreciate your inputs a lot. And I'm sure many of them will want to contact you in the future and have some of their doubts cleared. Okay. We want to say that there were lots more questions that we couldn't handle because of the constraints of time. But we will make sure that your questions are answered. And if you have further questions specific for Siddharth, you can contact him. If you have any questions that you want to ask through Sign, please go ahead and send us your queries too. But we will make sure that the unanswered questions are resolved in due time. I would like to thank Siddharth. I would like to extend our heartiest thanks from the Sign team to Siddharth for devoting this time, his time and energy, to help us navigate this very somewhat confusing space for many of us. And I'm sure this has been very informative for many of us who are hearing this for the first time, and it will help the early stage entrepreneurs to plan their journey accordingly. And at least they know now what they don't know, and they can educate themselves with regards to the regulation of their devices. Now, we would also like to let you know that the next in series for the Power Hour session is keeping with the same theme of medical devices. And it is basically the electromagnetic compatibility testing and certification for medical devices and non-medical devices. So if you're interested in this, please register. The registration link has already been provided in the chat box. Please visit also Sign's website and keep yourself tuned in for the other upcoming sessions. For this and other sessions, please subscribe to Sign's YouTube channel so that you can watch the sessions at ease and reach out to the appropriate people. We at Sign, we are here to help you with your queries, with any support that you need. For if you are interested in incubating with us, pre-incubating with us, please reach out to the email address incubation@signiitb.org. For questions related to the Biotechnology Ignition Grant, please reach out to sign_big@signiitb.org. Also, all of these email addresses are also available on our website. And we will help you navigate and facilitate your next grant. There is an upcoming BIG grant call. Am I audible now? Okay. With this, I would like to thank Siddharth once again. Okay. And I would like to thank all of the participants who spent their time trying to understand what Siddharth was trying to explain today. And I would like to thank the SIGN team who helped this webinar go on smoothly. And thank you all. And we hope to see you again in the future. And Siddharth, of course, you'll hear more from us.
Yeah,
so with that, I bring this session to a close. Okay.
Thank you all. Thank you for this.
Thank you.
Thank you.